Hey guys, SuperSonic123, aka John here. Welcome to episode 6 of the West Ham Career Mode. First of all, I want to explain myself as to lack of videos lately. So you've seen the episode 2, I believe, of The Journey coming up. Went up on Friday? Yeah, Friday. I've had a lot on my plate recently, and for that reason, I'm able to upload as often as I would like. I hadn't uploaded until the whole week before then. I just had a lot on my plate this week with school and so on, but hopefully I should be able to get back into some new things from now on, from next week and onwards for the next while. I should be able to upload more frequently. Fingers crossed, you should see a double upload. Not a double upload. You should see at least one video tomorrow, if not two. I'll try and get out to it if I can. Might not be possible. For the first game of today's episode, we take on Gothenburg away from home in the Europa League. In our first game in the Europa League, we did draw 2-2, Again, it's been so long, I just can't remember. At the start of this game, Sofyan Feghouli drove past a couple of men. Crossover led to Arthur Masuaku, a finished header would go over the bar. I did play a couple of fringe players because of the nature of the fixture that's coming just days before a Premier League game. Adrian will be forced to a good save by the Gothenburg player as he keeps it at 0-0. As the Swedish side pile pressure on us, Sofyan Feghouli would drive down the wing again, putting inside his man. He turns inside into his right foot. Andre Ayew picks it up. Andre Ayew shoots, and Andre Ayew makes it Gothenburg 0, West Ham United 1, as he drills the ball into the bottom corner past the keeper for the Swedish side and makes it 1-0 to the Hammers away in Sweden. And it was a very well worked goal as well as just driving on from Feghouli. We haven't seen much from the Algerian so far this season, but he cut inside. It came to Andre Ayew, and he shot right into the bottom corner. No chance for the keeper, and couldn't have been more direct into the corner. Could it have been from Andre Ayew? As he gets lifted into the air by his teammates as he makes it 1-0, giving him his first goal in the Europa League this season. Following that, Gothenburg would come forward here. This man here on the ball would have a shot. It would be saved by Adrian. No, it wouldn't be saved by Adrian. It would go wide of the post, and it would stay at 1-0 to West Ham. Apologies for that mistake. The number 8 for Gothenburg has an effort, and it does go wide of Adrian's post. Gothenburg come forward again here with the ball played into this guy, and he shoots and he scores. I couldn't see his name there, sorry. Now, I know if you're watching this in full screen, it'd be easy to see, but when I'm recording my voiceover, I have to look at this tiny screen. I can't look at the video on full screen and record at the same time, or at least if I have, I haven't found out a means of doing that. So anyway, just the striker for Gothenburg does make it 1-1. Disappointing to concede a goal just before half-time as well as an equaliser, but well-worked goal as it's played into the Gothenburg striker, and he shoots past Adrian to make it 1-1. And it was a pretty even first half as well, as you see there by the stats. Gothenburg did have their chances, and as did we. And then Gothenburg will come forward again here with Andersen, swinging the ball into the box towards his teammate, but the striker from the Swedish side would head past Adrian for a goal kick. Anyway, they come forward again, Gothenburg, with that man again finding his teammate into Andersen, and Andersen would shoot wide of the post. At least I think it's Andersen. I might be wrong. It just looks like Andersen the way I'm looking at it. And it will be 1-1 at full time as well. It'll finish 1-1. As you see, we have our Youth Scout monthly update. All these players, with the exception of this last guy, Lance Lee, is correct age. I think we released him actually because of his low overall. Yeah, and we keep those two 15-year-olds in our squad. And then we have our monthly scouting update. This guy from Ghana brings us back a bunch of players that we most likely won't be signing, like Isaac Samadi. We do sign this fella, and we do not sign him, but we do sign Yakini Amodako. And then our scout in Brazil brings us these group of lads, a lot of which we reject. The first three we reject. Four indeed, and we do reject Igor Cardoso. So a bad month for our scout in Brazil. But from England, these are the players that have been brought back by our youth scout. Again, a lot of bog-standard players. Charles Phillips we do sign, 70 to 94 potential. Hugh Cooper we would not sign. Jay Cooper we also reject. And Tyler White we do sign to our academy. And then For the second game of this episode, we take on Middlesbrough at the London Stadium in the Premier League. This game in real life occurred, well, two or three, no, it would have been 3 weeks ago because of the international break. And Payet scored a lovely solo goal as it finished a 1-1 draw between the teams. So we'll see if we can match or improve on that real-life result for the Hammers as we take a look at the new Premier League overlays. Of course, the first patch for the game has been released, and among them are these new overlays. I'm just going to let the intro play just in case for all three of you who haven't seen these already, can look at these new Premier League graphics. See even the table there, as we said, 3 points off the top four, with the game in hand on fourth place in Watford. And look at the West Ham people in the new London Stadium. What do you think of that? Again, the only reason I'm letting all of this play is so you can look at these beautiful graphics. It says a mountain to climb because we're the best defensive team and Middlesbrough are the worst attack. So the odds of Middlesbrough scoring too many passes isn't high. As you are just a bit boring. I just want to show you guys these new Premier League graphics because they are amazing. Like, they had them last year, but because Barkley's not the sponsor, they had to get the rights to them. So this is our lineup with it even shows the captain in blue and Andrew there in the bottom right. Then it shows the substitutes bench as you see who we had to bring off or to bring on on the occasion of us needing a goal or some such occurrence. As we shake hands with our opposition today. As get another look at me, or the guy to represent me, I suppose. As the Middlesbrough faithful, the Middlesbrough players become the officials. And the Middlesbrough team then, that's the team we've gone for Aitor Karanka's side, with Victor Valdes in goal, of course, and Alvaro Negredo on loan from Valencia up front, and Victor Ibarbo and Adama Traore on the bench, as well as championship veteran Jordan Rhodes. I'm sorry if this is a bit boring again, I'm apologising for this a lot, but anyway, Middlesbrough swinging the corner. Christian Suwani swinging the ball into the middle, and the header will be saved by Adrian out for a corner, and then we would retaliate. Andre Ayew picking the ball up, plays it out wide towards Mikael Antonio. He goes past Fabio, swings the ball into the box. It's met by Dimitri Payet, and Dimitri Payet makes it West Ham 1, Middlesbrough 0, as he volleys into the back of the net past Victor Valdes to make it 1-0 to the Hammers as he goes to celebrate with his teammates. A fantastically well-worked goal by us. The penalty was a fantastic cross. We haven't scored too many crosses in history. I haven't, anyway. You see, I can't remember. We scored hardly any goals from crosses last year with Everton or so far in this West Ham series. We get a goal there with a beautiful right profile by Dimitri Payet. Not as good as the one he scored against Middlesbrough in real life, but an honourable mention, anyway, as we see the another graphic here showing the these guys two Premier League goals so far for us anyway. So into the second half, Middlesbrough would try and get a equaliser, and they would, with Fabio playing in Alvaro Negredo, and Alvaro Negredo would, on the first time, half volley the ball into the back of that past his fellow Spaniard Adrian to make it West Ham 1, Middlesbrough 1. First time volley from the former Tottenham man and current Valencia man on loan at Middlesbrough, and the angled right foot shot would find its way into the back of the net. No way, Alvaro Negredo never played for Tottenham. He played for Manchester City. What am I on about? And he's currently, yeah, Alvaro Negredo. I'm mixing him up with Roberto Soldado, who was at Tottenham for a while and then flopped. But anyway, Andre Ayew finds Chico Cuillache, and the rebound we picked up by Sofyan Feghouli. And I scored what's possibly the weirdest goal I'll ever score in this series. As I wanted to shoot, I keep pressing shoot, but Feghouli wouldn't shoot. But he ends up walking the ball into the back of the net and making it 2-1, restoring our lead. Cuillache's shot is saved by Victor Valdes, but the number 26 can only parry to the Algerian Feghouli, and our number 7, well, quite bizarrely walks it into the back of the net. He wouldn't shoot when I told him to, but it doesn't matter. A goal is a goal, and I'm 50 minutes ago, my mind is ecstatic that we're able to restore our 2-1 lead and hopefully hold out for the 3 points. And we would hold out for the 3 points, just finish West Ham 2, Middlesbrough 1. Following that, we do have some player training here for Lafont Estevez and Reece Oxford. And Alvaro Estevez going up to 63 and Reece Oxford going up to 69 overall. I'm not going to make an inappropriate joke about Oxford's new overall, I swear to God. Anyway, we get an international management offer from Peru here. Again, like Russia, we stall it. The Russia offer expires in November, so we have a good while to make up our minds. Let me know in the comments below if you want me to manage an international team and what team you'd like me to manage. As I keep reminding us, in my Everton series last year, I did Ireland. I went to Euro 2016 with them, and I also took them to the World Cup in the end, but I didn't play that because we didn't get to finish the series. So anyway, for the third and final game of this episode, we take on our fellow London rivals Crystal Palace at Selhurst Park in, of course, the game which in real life happened last week, last Saturday, with Saturday Night Football, with West Ham winning the game 1-0. But as you get another look at these Premier League overlays, I think I play most of this intro as well, if not all of it. I do, actually. I apologise for that if you get bored. But you can always skip ahead to... I don't know when. Look at this, but wouldn't be offended if you did that. We went from top three with that game, and we sit just behind Crystal Palace on goal difference, both on 16 points. I didn't actually notice this until I started recording my voiceover, that we were so close in the table. As opposed to the best attack against the weakest, no, the recent weakest attack against the best defence, as was the case in the last game, this game is the best attack against the best defence, so. Like a real clash of the Titans, I guess. And we'll see if Crystal Palace can improve on Minsk's goal tally of one against us, as how they line up with big man Christian Benteke up front. And they do have some firepower from the bench with Zaha and Remy, and potentially Conor Whitman able to come off the bench, but Remy and Zaha will be the more fiery and pacey of those two. As we get a look at my manager facing up against Alan Pardew, the former Newcastle, West Ham, and among others, manager. I think he managed Charlton at one point. And this is our team, back to the usual first 11 at 3. Again, I'm routing this slightly with regard to the Europa League games, because I want a fully fit team for more or less every game. And we do have good strength and depth here at West Ham, as James Tompkins, starting centre back for Crystal Palace, having moved from West Ham in the summer. So I think that's interesting. If he was still at West Ham, I wouldn't have played him, because I don't really rate him as highly as the centre-backs we have at the club. I would play Reece Hoffman before I play Tompkins, in all honesty. Anyway, Crystal Palace would attack us here with Pape Suare going past the challenge of Masuaku. He finds his way into the box, drills it in. The ball is saved by Adrian following the deflection from Winston Reid. But Christian Benteke is on hand to finish into the back of the empty net to make it Crystal Palace 1, West Ham 0. He does this weird celebration. As he makes it 1-0 to Crystal Palace following this move from the summer. It's a bizarre goal. It's drilled in by Pape Suare. It's deflected by Winston Reid, saved by Adrian, but it falls as far as the Belgian Benteke as he finishes in the back of the net to make it Crystal Palace 1 West Ham 0. So we do fall behind in this game, unfortunately, and it would be Crystal Palace 1 West Ham 0 at half-time. So we need something special in the second half if we wanted to come back from this. But Mikel Antonio would pick up the ball here on the right-hand side. He would fight a couple of players, and he would finish ecstatically into the top corner of the net to make it Crystal Palace 1, West Ham 1. As we equalise at Selhurst Park against our London rivals, as the ball played in from Lanzini into Antonio. He cuts inside a couple of West Ham defenders, including Suare and Dan, and he finishes it past the Frenchman, Steve Mandanda, to make it 1-1. As Mikel Antonio has been a very good player for us. I'm starting him on the right-hand side against higher-rated players that we have in the team, but I think that's paying off for us more or less. I mean, he's got 2 goals in the Premier League, and he's a good performer for us. And then with 10 minutes to go here, Paya would find Manuel Lanzini. He would roll in Simone Zaza, and Simone Zaza, with 10 minutes to go, would give us the lead as he dabs in celebration the Italian Zaza to make it Crystal Palace 1, West Ham 2. As we complete the comeback, and we do have the lead now, 10 minutes to go, and we do put Crystal Palace on the back foot as he rolls it ever so calmly past the French international Mandanda into the back of the net. It's just a calm, collected finish from Zaza as he gets his first goal for us in any competition, actually, as the loanee from Juventus gets his first goal in a West Ham shirt, at least in this save, I suppose, in real life. And it just finished Crystal Palace 1, West Ham 2. Crystal Palace did, by the looks of things, play better than us. One interesting thing, we did manage to match our shirt sales goal for the year already. Am I the only one who finds that a bit bizarre? Well, either way, we have matched our shirt sales goal for the season, so that's always nice, as that's a goal we had. So in the next episode, guys, we do face on Roma, face on Roma. We face Roma, face Sunderland at home in the Premier League, and Leicester City in the EFL Cup Round of 16. And to finish off the episode, guys, you do have a squad report. I want to do a squad report for every month, because that's when the overalls are updated, so you see how the players are getting on in terms of their growth. Sorry, I'm holding back a sneeze. I don't want to sneeze on recording. And you see how the players are getting on. I do like this West Ham side. I really, really like this West Ham side. That's why I wanted to do a career mode with them, and that's why I put them in the poll, and you guys voted for them, presumably for that reason as well. One of the most unfortunate things, or one of the most disappointing things, as you see here coming up now, Dimitri Payet has gone down to 85. And that's just really upsetting. Anyway, thanks for watching this video, guys. Make sure to comment, like, and subscribe, and I'll see you for the next episode of the series very soon.